And the last panelist here to my right is Dr. Badru Hasan from Zanzibar University and Kampala International University from Tanzania. And his presentation is entitled Children's Safety and Ethno-Religious Armed Conflicts in the 21st Century. So this is a case of Africa's Great Lakes region.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We are looking at the children's safety and ethno-religious armed conflicts in the 21st century, taking a case study of Africa's Great Lakes region. Africa's Great Lakes region has 12 countries, in the addition of Southern Sudan as the last country in it. And this is the region that has been affected, that has been an epicenter, a war theater on the African continent, where children are considered to live in a worst place. And it is sometimes recorded that this is the worst place on earth for children to stay, and the women. The beginning of the suffering of the children in this Great Lakes region starts when potential fathers or men fail to go and take up arms together with others in the conflicts whose objectives are not genuine to them. Fathers will run away, they leave their wives and children, or fathers will be killed because of not participating in the wars, and the children will be left behind to suffer, either in the hands of the mothers or in their own hands as the child parents. In the Great Lakes region, the situation has been brought by insecurity. It has brought in place detrimental situations on the side of the children, poverty, illiteracy, and children join the army at the earliest age. Before coming to this conference, in my research I was sharing with the ambassador of Southern Sudan. He described the fighters in his region, Southern Sudan, and said, these were the children of yesterday who never had opportunities to go to schools. They grew up with guns in their hands. They have never had any savior, and today they are over 30 years still fighting. Meaning that the Great Lakes region is the world's largest producer of disadvantaged children and bush-born militia who will never have any other vocabulary of peace rather than violence. There are so many causes of these conflicts, but the roots are, in the first place, insecurity. Whenever the children realize that we don't have security, they will opt for an alternative. And that is one way of how they will be suffering. The social injustices, this is done by the governments and the communities. The economic inequality on the side of the Eastern DRC that was left behind for more than 40 years from the period of Mobutu up to the present moment. Political and religious radicalism on the side of Western Uganda and perhaps in other areas of the Great Lakes region, acute racism and nationalism. In some countries, that the nationalist tendencies prove to be more prominent to the extent that the rest will have to suffer in the hands of the few. So these have created political and economic oppression by foreign interests, coupled with civil wars and military tensions primarily supported by hatred, corruption, exploitation, and terror. On Africa's grotesque region now, there is too much poverty that is eating up the communities. Hunger does not have an end. Diseases, illiteracy, and violence, among others, are the problems that are facing the children, most especially the Southern Sudan and now the eastern part of the Democratic Republic of Congo. These armed conflicts of the Greater region have created other bigger impacts, especially when the children lose their lives or when they cannot contain themselves. They can't move on simply because they have lost. The mother is dead, the father is dead, or the father is dead and the child cannot move on well alone. And this situation has remained a regional problem, yet with less international concern. And I'm sure that the world has not yet come up with a clear-cut definition of how the young children will be served in terms of armed conflicts. And in significant number of conflicts, violence takes place in areas where the civilians are the most target, and this one has increased a number of mutilation, violence, rituals, and so on. Ladies are always looked at as the potential targets, and therefore they have to escape. Between 1998 to 2005, only the Democratic Republic of Congo lost 5.4 million. Where among these cases, 250 women were claimed to be raped or defiled. And the biggest number of people who suffered and died during that season, only in the Great Lakes, in the Eastern Democratic Republic of Congo, was for the children. This gives a true picture of what we are talking about. And those that remain free and alive are taken as refugees with all the coupled problems, like famine, like poverty. This is covering the whole region. There will be no developments if the region is hosting refugees. At least every country is hosting refugees or producing refugees. Whereas other people live in refugee situations within their own countries. Look at Kenya, look at Burundi, look at Rwanda, look at DRC, Southern Sudan, Western Uganda, to mention but a few. As a result of all this, there are so many cries in African families that have created such kinds of insecurity and detrimental poverty. And finally, children are made to join the army at the earliest age. Somebody on the children who are fighting, on the armies that are fighting on the Great Lakes region, the biggest community within the armies is yesterday's young children, child soldiers. They've grown up now, they are 30 years, but they have been 30 years in the bush. They were born in the bush, or they were captured as they were still young, or they ran away from the parents, or they became child-dependent households. A child of 8 years looking after the four children that are under because the parent has disappeared permanently, and these, at the end of the day, find their ways in the hands of the rebels. Rebels have murdered them, and therefore there is no more chance of bringing them back to the life without a gun. What Africans have to do, and maybe the world over, may not be to take away the gun from such a person, but instead, making such a person take out a gun from his heart, though he will remain with it. Because of the problems that have been mentioned, The solutions are many, but in the interest of time, let us look at the three that will be covered in the rest. Number one is employing ethnicity and religion in peacebuilding. In African societies and in other societies elsewhere in the world, we find the problem is a religious, but a religious man has not been involved in solving it. Then it will not end. Whichever country that has a religious armed conflict, the religious community has to be involved to end that conflict. Number two, the point of forgiveness. Wherever we lead, whether social, whether political, whether religious settings, the point of forgiveness has always been our value. But what is it in our hearts? This has to be reminded every time and again, such that people appreciate the value of living with others and the value of forgiveness. Then we have to reconcile. Whichever war that is taking place, the end must be reconciliation. So before we start fighting, let us put the point of reconciliation at the forefront, such that when there is room for reconciliation, everybody is inviting it with both arms. Recommendations. The United Nations, local and international organizations, including faith-based institutions, need to re-internalize, interpret the physical and human information or ideological settings in which the root causes of conflicts take place. For example, the law permits people who are less privileged to fight for their freedom democratically. And that is why we have freedom fighters, because they are supported by the international law. So this is what I'm talking about. Much as it is there, they have been given the consent, there is need for the freedom fighters to be rechecked. Not all freedom fighters are truly freedom fighters. And you find someone's freedom fighter is another man's enemy. So this will mean that if the consent, if the permission is not checked, we shall end up killing and losing our families and societies. Number two, we need to support peaceful negotiations wherever they are. Number three, help to restrict attacks to military objects, but not targeting civilians and children. Every rebel group, I was doing a research and I asked the former rebels of the Allied Democratic Forces in Western Uganda. They said there is no way we can leave the society, because if the killings don't take place on the civilians, government will not wake up. So they have to kill as many as possible, such that it creates awareness. So this was a rebel, a former rebel, but now an amnesty. Next is that we have to empower and monitor religious institutions that defend children. Whenever children are suffering in a war, communities fear to come up simply because they will be pinpointed. So these ones need support from different governments and stakeholders, and training enough manpower that can be employed throughout the nations to assist in avoiding battlefields, in avoiding making battlefields the last resort. Whenever a war is taking place, or whenever a conflict emerges in society, we shouldn't think of taking up arms as the last resort. Let us give a chance to peaceful negotiations. This will bring us together, and we will always live together for peace. Thank you for listening.